12 o'clock on a Wednesday, and this is the Wizard Product Review. I'm Dave.
I'm Craig.
And that's Blammo. And on this week's show.
You know, we don't always get a great deal of stage items that come out for review. Very exciting, because we now have, in for review, we've got our hot sticky little fingers on Stretching the Truth.
By Tim Gabrielson.
I have been waiting for this with bated breath for absolutely ages. When I first saw this, it was on The Magicians, and Pete Furman did it. And I immediately said, that's one of the best comedy stage routines I've ever seen. Yep. I tried to actually order it directly from the guy, and the shipping was just so astronomical. I was right. Like, oh, I'm just not going to be able to get it. But now, obviously,
we've got them in style.
And it's fantastic.
And basically the routine, if you've seen it, it's a comedy routine, like you said. You can kind of get... have a look at that. You can kind of get a kid out if you're doing like an illusion show or something like that. Or it could be a great comedy routine. Personally, I think it's better for a kid.
Yeah.
Because what happens, you say you're making a prediction, and you're going to predict an animal, and they reach into the box of cookies, and you get all the cookies with it as well.
Yeah, you get
box.
Two boxes of cookies.
The animal crackers, and they freely choose one of the animal crackers. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of comedy here, because you kind of draw a very generic animal, don't you?
Like the traditional gag of... Yes,
and if they say elephant, you add a trunk on, and if they say rhino, you do the horn.
Yeah.
But then there's a problem, obviously, in the routine, whether the kid or your volunteer chooses a giraffe.
Yeah.
And you say, oh, you need the spots, and you put the spots on there. Nice gag. And say, well, he's obviously a giraffe with a neck affliction.
Yeah, red generic neck injury.
There's loads of gags with it. It's all written for you. And then in the traditional sort of cardiographic style, the neck rises, but it really becomes part of the picture when you take it off. And it's a great gift. You can then sign it and give them that sheet of newspaper. There's no moving parts. There's nothing. It's absolutely fantastic.
It really is.
The first time I ever saw anything like this... It was in David Copperfield's show, where he did a very large version of the cardiographic.
Oh, yeah.
And I remember watching it. I was only about 12, 13 at the time. And when he tears off the piece of paper and says, that really is part of the picture. I think we forget sometimes, as magicians, how amazing that is.
Well,
it doesn't move.
Yeah. And there's something amazing about seeing a drawing animate and then giving that drawing out to someone to keep, especially for children, because, you know, children are always watching cartoons and they're reading comic books, and in their imagination they're imagining these like drawings coming to life, and to actually see that right in front of them and then get it given to them as a souvenir, it's fantastic. It really is. Like I say, the first time I saw Pete Furman do this, I knew that I wanted to do this.
A little bit disappointed it wasn't all entirely made up for me. Maybe that's me. Maybe I'm just lazy.
Yeah, let's get into that. On the DVD, you get a big box of stuff. Now, they have gone into great detail. You get everything that you need to perform this, right down to the smallest
thing. And prepare
it
and create it.
Yeah, so, but everything that you need. Like, at one point, you need sellotape. I'm not giving anything away by saying you need a beaker.
No.
And they've given you a roll of sellotape. Like
you get everything.
You get everything. You also get a lovely spiral-bound booklet, which has got the complete script in it, which is fantastic. The effort and the care they've gone to in this is fantastic. You get a folder with Stretching the Truth on that you can keep all the props in, and it's a working routine.
Even the wallet that holds the DVD is first class.
It is. It's all nice. Now, there's no live performance on the DVD, but the DVD does what it's meant to do. It takes you through step by step how to perform it, all the subtleties, and then how to make it a feature of your act. And I guarantee you that if you do parlour, stage, kids' work.
Going straight into your number one set?
It's going straight into my number one set.
I thought it really might. Want to mention as well, because it's not on the ad copy, but there's a certificate of authenticity and performing rights. You are the proud owner of Stretching the Truth by Clever Guys. By purchasing this, you have distinguished yourself as a magician of the highest caliber and having very good taste in magic. This signed a numbered certificate entitles you to perform this effect in live performances, excluding the rights to perform this effect on TV or other video medium at the Magic Castle or any other magic-related venue. So you can't do it on YouTube. You can't really do it in a magic related venue. I don't think he means if you wanted to do it in like a club competition.
I don't think that'd
like
be a
that.
Problem. But I mean, Pete Furman did it on TV, so I'm sure he's happy to extend the rights. He just needs to be contacted first.
Maybe.
I don't know.
We don't know that. We can't say that.
Not too sure. But it's not cheap, is the thing about this. So I think the people that are buying it.
Yeah.
Are going to buy it because they have an idea of where they're going to use it.
Yes.
I think a lot of people, you talk about this a lot of the time, close-up guys that are wanting to put a cabaret set together for themselves to do as an add-on to their close-up gigs. I think this is fantastic because it packs flat.
Well, the whole thing, he describes how you can put the cookies in a tube at the end and then it will all pack flat and go into your briefcase kind of thing. And you even get like a little carrying thing, don't you?
One thing that we haven't mentioned, it's only a two to five minute reset.
Yes.
You can reset the whole thing in 2 to 5 minutes, but it will take you a good couple of hours to build the thing initially. But once you've built it, it's a one-off thing. You'll never have to do that again. And then it's only 2 minutes to reset it in between performances, which isn't a problem in my mind for something
That's
like this.
The only negative. Everything else is fantastic. I'll give it 91%.
I'm giving it 94. It's going straight into my act. I think it's brilliant. I can't believe finally I've got it.
So now we're going to look at something that I actually looked at about 3 weeks ago.
Yeah.
But we actually said we can't put him on again this week.
Yeah, because it seems to be becoming the Wayne Fox Show. It was a product of you, otherwise known as the Wayne Fox Show.
And this is knockout prediction. And I can do it because I opened it 3 weeks ago.
And now you can do it.
I can do it already. So get it off the sticks, John. And we'll have a look at this.
Okay. I'm excited about this.
You're right with that. Right, this, Craig, is my prediction deck of cards.
Okay.
This is my prediction deck. I'm going to get these out and show you there's nothing funny about these in a second. And you can have a look through this deck as well. Just go through, and I just want you to check that they're not in the same order or anything like that, not in any special order.
No, they're not. No.
In fact, to prove that they're not in any special order at all, I'm going to have you give the cards a shuffle. So give them a shuffle.
Yeah,
is that fair? That's fair,
that's
isn't
fair,
it,
that's
John?
Fair. Definitely fair.
I want this to be absolutely fair. So, are you happy that you shuffled there?
Absolutely, 100%.
Do you want to change your mind at all?
No, I'm happy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you want to shuffle any more?
No, I don't.
You sure?
Yeah.
Okay. And you stop shuffling just there.
Yeah, I do.
Turn over that top card.
Okay.
And. You didn't want to shuffle anymore.
No, I was happy with that.
The intriguing thing, John, you know, I just wondered, why did Craig stop shuffling just there? I have no idea why he did that. That's quite weird, isn't it?
That's cool.
Should we try it again? We'll try something different this
time. Go on, then.
give him a shuffle. Give him a shuffle. I don't care. I don't care. And we want to follow this time the same procedure that you would do if you were playing a legitimate game of cards. So you shuffle, so give them a cut. Cut a few cards off the top.
Yeah.
And put them into my hand.
Mm-hmm.
And now cut some into your hand. Okay. Are you happy there?
Yeah, I'm happy.
Do you want to cut any more? Are you happy?
No, I'm happy right there.
You sure?
I'm happy right there.
Positive?
Absolutely positive.
Do you want to change your mind? Because you know what happened last time.
No, I'm happy.
You sure?
Yeah, I'm happy.
Let me see if I can do this. I'm just going to cut a bit further down in my deck.
Okay.
Right there. And I'm going to turn over my card at the same time as you turn over yours.
Okay.
Is that fair?
That's
so
fair,
you've
yeah.
cut and I've
yeah,
cut.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
And you shuffle the cards.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Turn over your card.
So cool. It's pretty.
It's quite nice, isn't it?
It's brilliant.
And the fun thing is, when you play with this, this principle that's at play here.
What?
You kind of jazz with it. It's quite nice.
You've shown this to me. He's shown this to me off camera about 7 or 8 times, and each time he's shown it me, it's been a completely different revelation. Like,
well, you just do whatever you want to do, really. And I showed Mark in the shop, Mark and Matthew, and they were like, "How does that work?" And it is a real, real magician fool.
When you first showed it me, I was completely and totally fooled. I had no idea how it works.
Does that fool you, John, as well?
Yeah.
It's brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant. What I love about this, because you've now obviously told me how it works and I've got a chance to watch the DVD myself. What I love about this is this blue deck is your working deck, right?
Yeah, I guess it is. Yeah,
you have to. I can now go into an ambitious card or whatever I want to.
Yeah. Oh, you can do anything with the deck. Yeah. Absolutely
so
anything.
So I'm now set to go with a different trick in my repertoire.
I would prefer to leave that deck separate to my working deck, to be honest with you. But right. I know you can.
You can do.
It's a regular deck.
It is a regular deck. And I can go into a different routine and then be set to do this anytime I want to.
Yeah, it'd just be my luck. You know, somebody would end up signing the wrong card or something like that. So I'd rather keep that separate. If I was going to do that,
and that I love it because it's a little. It reminds me a little bit of the trick that can't be explained. Because you genuinely don't know what you're going to do, but there's no memory work to it at all.
No,
there's absolutely no memory
That's
work.
A you very don't have strong
to.
Point.
Yeah, you don't have to memorize anything. You spend 10 or 15 minutes setting these decks up as per Wayne's instructions on the DVD.
You say decks. That's something I want to point out. So a lot of people probably think, you know, I've got to carry two decks around. We did this because this is kind of like the way Wayne goes through it on the trailer and that sort of thing. And on the DVD. But you don't actually have to have the red deck. You can have predictions in your wallet, that sort of thing. However you
That's
want
true.
To reveal those
so,
predictions.
So people that are worried about their pocket space issues, you don't even need to have this red deck.
Yeah,
you can just have that working deck that can be your working deck and you can be ready to do this routine anytime you want to. But if you've got the red deck with you, you can go into some very cool.
I think it's more of a magician fool than it is a. Well, I don't know, to be honest with you.
That was going to be my argument. Coming into this, I thought to myself, self, I'm going to argue with Dave about this because I think it's more of a trick for magicians. But having now watched you perform it again, you shuffle, they shuffle, you turn over the top cards, they match. How is that not impressive
well, that's
to
the way
a layman?
Craig remembers it.
Yeah, that's exactly how I remember it. And that is
I'll take that.
As impressive.
I shuffled, I'm sure I did, yeah.
Yeah, that's as impressive for a layman as it is for a magician.
Yeah.
Sometimes we talk about magician foolers and this is a trick just for magicians. But if it fools a magician, it's going to fool a layman. So as long as
or
it's...
Or bore them.
But this isn't boring. This isn't boring.
No, it's not. As a demonstration of dead cutting and that kind of thing, I think it's really nice.
And I saw you earlier do... I thought you were using an invisible deck. You got me to think, you know.
Yeah, when I first got Craig to do this, the very first time we did it was one of the best revelations. When he shuffled, he cut to a card, and I just spread those, and it was the only one I'd left face up.
It was brilliant.
And that's, you know, that happens quite a bit when you play around with it as well.
It's awesome.
It's really nice.
Wayne's a good teacher as well.
Yeah, it's not a, you know, Spielberg DVD. It's basically Wayne dead on, just in his front room, talking about the stuff, going through everything you need to know. All the information is there. It's obvious that he's worked it. I'll give it 89%.
Yeah, I'm gonna play around with this. I'm gonna try it out, and I really like it. I'm gonna give this 90%.
So only three reviews this week because we're off to this tiny little magic convention next week.
Oh, this little thing, the FISM,
otherwise known as the Jan Fritz year.
Yeah, that's what everyone's
saying he's going to win. People are coming in the shop going, oh, he's going to win. So it'd be interesting.
It'd be very interesting. So. But we love FISM because obviously we've got some new stuff coming out and we're going to have a cracking time on the stand.
Well, first of all, Tom Crosby's going to be on the stand. And obviously we've just launched Recall and Tom will be on the stand quite a bit doing some demonstrations. Mm.
If you want to be fooled, come over and watch Tom perform anything off that DVD. And as a side effect as well, if you've ever heard of the game Where's Wally?
Yeah.
That old game where you've got a big, massive picture and you've got to find the little guy.
Wally's got quite an individual look, hasn't he?
Yeah, he's got the stripy T-shirt and the woolly hat.
It never changes.
Yes, that's true.
Yeah. And we were actually thinking that Tom Crosby's a bit like that.
Yeah, that's true.
Because he's got the white shirt and the waistcoat and the glasses.
Never changes.
So we're going to be playing Where's Tom Crosby?
And we're going to be posting pictures on our Facebook wall. And you have to find Tom Crosby. It might be a picture of the dealer hall. It might be a picture somewhere
on the
else.
Beach.
And yeah, you never know. And we're going to be giving away prizes.
Come up to the stand. Or even if you're at home, not at the convention that day, because perhaps you've got a day ticket on another day or something like that.
The hilarious thing is we haven't actually told Tom about this
yet.
No,
we haven't told him. But it's happening.
It's happening, yeah.
Trust us, it's happening. Tom Wright will be there as well, so don't forget to tag Tom Wright in Blackpool.
Wherever you are, tag him.
Yeah, it's always fun when he gets back and tries to explain it to his
missus. He'll be there with his cards.
And what's that, John?
He'll be
Deming Chill as well and everything else. He's got some other stuff coming out.
He's got some great stuff. Look out for Tom Wright.
That thing with the serial number he does. Yeah, he's not brought that out yet.
It's amazing.
But it is incredible. And a certain bottle production.
Oh, good grief. Everybody is coming up to me at the moment and they're talking about, tell me about Dave Penn's bottle production. Tell me about it. And you've done a kind of a soft launch on this and you've shown people in the shop and they've just gone gaga for it.
Now, it's something that I used in my Magic Circle close-up competition routine.
To win it.
Coming up at the end of this show, we're going to put an MP3 on, which was sent to us by Chris Richards. We're going to try and get it on at the end of the show. It's from the DVD, because he's one of the first people to buy it.
Funniest thing I've ever heard
and,
in my life.
He's taken sound bites from it and made it into a song. God knows how he's done it, but that's coming up at the end of the show.
By the way, there's an argument on the Magic Cafe, which isn't
right.
unusual, but there's an argument on the bottle production. I know you don't read the cafe. People are saying that the bottle production trailer, they don't actually see the moment that the bottle's stolen. It's that good because you do actually see on the trailer the moment the
bottle's
production.
There's a caption going along at the same time,
mm-hmm.
but the actual production is shown on the trailer.
Exactly.
But there's a caption there.
It is really,
it's
really
where I'm
good.
Stood at the pool table and you see one appear and then the other one appears secondary.
Yeah.
It's that second production. But I also do the glass from the table as well, the spectator's glass. Come up and see it on the stand.
Yeah,
it's one of those things you've got to see, really. And this thing, that superstar that came in recently.
Matthew Underhill. Fame has gone to his head.
Wow.
He's brought out
He's at the spa right now.
Chilling out.
He's at the spa, but hopefully he has a rider now. We have to fulfil that. You know, he's at the spa most of the time.
You know when you can't really put much ad copy on the DVD cover because you've just got to cover it with quotes that you know that it's a good product. And the quotes that he's been getting from this are brilliant. Nick Einhorn's never said to me, I want it in my close-up case for anything I've ever done. I mean,
it's crazy, you know. And a lot of people are talking about this, saying it's the new anniversary waltz. It is fantastic. It's a great visual moment.
But please don't come up to the stand and congratulate him too much. His head's big enough
already.
Seriously,
please, yeah, leave it. And another thing as well, on the DVD, we've got extra handlings by Justin Miller.
Mm-hmm.
Which you can download as well, where Justin absolutely loved the effect. He got back in touch with us on Skype and said, you know what, I've got some ideas with this. Justin was kind enough to put those ideas in downloadable format so you can access those as well. It's like another 30 minutes of bonus material. He's got this great thing where you rip the card in half, two hearts on either side.
Mm-hmm.
You put one half in one person's hand, one half in the other person's hand.
Yep.
And he says, I'm going to get those two to go together again. How clever is that?
So clever.
And they think the card's going to go together, but absolutely, when they turn it over, there's only one heart, and this one's got the three hearts on this side because they've gone over.
It's beautiful.
Really, really nice. And he's got some great lines in patter. Thank you very much, Justin, for doing that. And we're going to see you at FISM and find Tom Crosby.
So finally, the last review this week is Poor Man's Cups and Balls. By the Jam and Soda Company.
Right.
A packet trick by Stephen K. So or something like that. I don't know. An all-time classic that fits in your pocket. I'm going to talk about this.
Yeah, because there's a reason that tricks last a lifetime, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They become classics.
And there's a reason why they don't.
Yeah, I don't think it's because they come in things like this. But
anyway, I literally opened this up half an hour ago.
Yeah.
I can do it already.
Right,
we're going to get into it. I can tell you're excited. And then we're going to talk all about it. So first of all, John, can you get it off the sticks? Now, there's a rites of passage for magicians, and it's something called the cups and the balls, where you have three cups, three balls, the balls go underneath the cups, and you have to manipulate them. And you can't be considered a magician, a proper magician, until you've learned this cups and balls.
Right.
In actual fact, a lot of people don't realise this, but Prince Charles is actually a member of the Magic Circle.
Yeah.
If you go to the Magic Circle headquarters in London, you can see the cups and the balls he used in his audition.
Can I tell you something now? I didn't know you were going to say that. For all Magic Circle members out there that boast about that and go, oh yeah, Prince Charles knows the cups and balls. I actually, about 4 years ago, I met Prince Charles at Stratford-upon-Avon.
Okay.
And they were launching like all Shakespeare's stuff on DVD or something. And he was there. I didn't know he was going to be there, but there was security everywhere. And he came over and spoke to me. And I said, oh, yes, I know you're a member of the Magic Circle. And I know you can perform the cups and balls. And he went, oh, I've probably forgotten it all now. So there you go. So it Prince was, Charles doesn't know the cups
he
and doesn't balls. Know,
but at one point he did.
One point he did, because he's forgotten it. And that's straight from him, he told me.
He's got more important stuff to do, like, you know, I don't know what, but I'm sure he's got something important to do. But anyway.
Take Camilla to see The Amazing Spider-Man.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Which is very good, by the way. Anyway, moving on. So I'm going to do a version of the cups and the balls.
What the hell is that thing?
Using playing cards.
It's like a hairy apple.
Well, I've taken a thing that's gone 3D and turned it 2D. I'm not going to use cups and balls.
By the way, during this, we're going to be playing a game that we always like to play called John and Dave Try to Put Off Craig While He Remembers All the Phases.
There's a lot of phases to remember. Anyway, so I'm going to do the same sort of thing.
With the hairy apples.
With the hairy apples. These are actually balls.
They're
little
fluffy
balls.
Can't you say hairy apples from now on?
Okay, I'll call them hairy apples. So I have three hairy apples, and I also have three cups.
Okay.
Solid cups. Solid cups. Now, the idea is very simple. I'm going to perform this just as you would see them do at the Covent Garden and the streets. I'm going to do exactly the same thing. So I'm going to take the cups, and I'm going to stack them up into a little stack. Three cups stacked up just like that. Shut up. Then I'm going to take one of the hairy apples.
Little stack.
And it goes right there on top of the middle cup. Notice it goes right there on top of the middle cup. Now, the idea...
Can't you cover it like you're covering it?
I could do just like that.
That's better, isn't it?
Now, the idea is to make solid go straight through solid. You tap the top of the cup. That's the signal for the magic to happen. That's when the first ball drops right through, leaving just one, two, three cups. I'm going to do it again. I'm going to do
really?
It again. I'm going to take...
How long?
I'm going to take... There's several phases. I'm going to take ball number two, put it right there on top of the middle
That's
cup.
That's better. That looks
like
better.
That. And nothing happens to tap the top of the cup. And when I do, solid goes straight through solid. That's the second ball going straight through, leaving just three cups.
Oh, please.
Last time I got one ball. It goes right here.
Can't we do the Williamson two-cup routine instead?
No. It goes right here on top of the middle cup. And all I have to do is tap. And when I do, solid goes straight through solid. And that's when the third ball goes straight through. Nice subtlety.
Nice subtlety.
Straight through. Just like that. Now I'm going to go one step further. I am going to go one step further if I can remember the routine. I'm going to take the three balls and put them on top of the three cups. On top of each three cups. And I'm going to take all three.
Is this the Vernon routine where we explain the vanish at this
point? No. I'm not going to go into the Vernon routine. We're going to cut it down slightly. So the three hairy apples, or the balls, whatever you want to say, they go right there on top of the bottom cup. These two cups go on top.
Yeah.
So in other words, there's two cups on top of the three balls that is on top of the middle cup. Now watch.
All three balls
through at the same time. It's when I tap and shake, just like that. The three balls drop all the way through.
Yeah.
But this is the big finish, Dave. This is the big finish. Thank God I hear you say. The three balls are going to get mixed to in between the cups. I'm going to mix the three balls right here in between the cups. And I'm going to put two cards down over here. Two cards down over here and two cards down over here. And you have to guess, are the three balls under one cup, what cup, or that cup, or is the one ball under each one?
One under each one.
You think so?
What do you think, John?
Yeah, I think under each one.
Yeah.
One under each one. Well, you see, this is the part of the trick that nobody ever understands, because there were never any balls. Under that one, you've got a lemon.
It's good. They pass through the
under
top of the cup.
One, yes,
passes
they do.
Through the top of the cup.
Oh, and you got a lime. And that one, you've got an orange.
Okay.
And that's
well,
the
there
trick.
You go. That's the poor man's cups and
that's
balls.
That's the poor man's cups and balls. And you know what?
It's all right.
It's not all right. It's not all right. Let's be honest with ourselves. It's not all right. It's a steaming pile of cack is what it is. Because why would you take a fantastic routine like the cups and balls and trivialise it and turn it into playing card naffiness like this? I actually did this to a
People
layman.
Might like that.
I learnt this afternoon, and a magician came in with his friend, a lady, and she was a layman. I showed it to her and she was clapping along and she goes, ah, that's good.
Yeah.
And at the end,
I don't remember her clapping actually.
Yeah,
but
she was excited. And at the end, she was, I could tell. And at the end, she said, oh, can I look at those cards?
It wasn't that she wanted to look. She wanted to turn them over, didn't she?
She did.
You were like, she went like this, and you were like, oh, no, lemon. It looks good.
And that's the thing. You can't examine these cards. You can't examine them. Immediately, you have to take them and put them away before they do anything with it, which is a major, 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 major problem because the routine screams.
I think there's a bit
please
of a...
Please let me examine it.
You know, with this chop cup thing that came out like a week or so ago, it's like, let's take the classic and butcher it completely and find some way of making it terrible.
And it, I can't understand why they've done this, because you need all this table space to perform this. So it's not like you can do this when you can't do the cups and balls. If you've got this amount of
and,
table space.
And to be honest, I don't think laymen are get the in-jokes and that. A magician's going to watch it and go, oh, yeah, I see what they've done there. They've taken that classic routine and made it into a packet card trick. And they appreciate it for different things. Whereas I don't think a layman would really appreciate it at all.
No, I really don't think it. It's terrible. It's got no redeeming qualities at all. No, actually, the one redeeming qualities are that this. If you don't want to have the final production of the fruits, you can have these wonderful little cards, and you can produce three little... You don't want to turn them over. You can produce three little rabbits holding the balls, which is an alternate ending. No DVD.
That makes
it comes
sense.
In a little book. It's just terrible. The book is
You're
actually...
not buying it for the book, John. Oh, my God, it's going to be straight in the chart next week.
Oh, no, gosh, yeah, it will be, won't it?
Thanks to everybody that wrote in.
And here at number one this week.
Poor man's cups and balls, number one.
It's a wonderful little routine with a fantastic little
we
book.
We had everybody commenting going, you're right. We got the most likes for that.
It's a chart show. That is just
Don't go on about it again. That's it this week for the Wizard Product Review.
You haven't given it a mark.
Oh.
I'm giving it 5%.
4%. That's it this week for the Wizard Product Review. We're going to be at FISM. Remember, tag Tom Wright, find Tom Crosby.
And come and say hello to us.
Come and say hello and see us dem some stuff.
Yeah.
What's new for you coming out?
I've got absolutely nothing new, but I'll be demming the same old stuff that I've been demming for the last 5 years.
And all the Workers of the Week.
And I'll be demming all the Workers of the Week. If you haven't got any of my material, please come and see me. If you want to see a Worker of the Week dem, come and see me and I'll show you the packaging.
But we'll be there.
Yeah.
See you next week. Don't forget, subscribe. Facebook.
Twitter. YouTube and whatever
We're
else.
We're losing it. It's a bad finish. See you next week. I'm Dave.
I'm Craig.
See you next week.
But it only takes a couple of seconds. But it only takes a couple of seconds. Not something you can really do in front of spectators.
Not going to be any bulge in there at all.
I've done it when you've been waiting to start. I've actually picked it up and put it in there, and I've been stood at the side of two waitresses at the side of the room, and nobody's looking at you, but you reach under your jacket.
There's not going to be any bulge in there at all.
You will find it comes out a lot easier if it's just a bit further up. If you don't jump around, it's not going to come out. If you don't jump around, it's not going to come out.
It only takes a couple of seconds.
You should be able to reach just under your jacket and just feel the end of bulge in there at all.
Can you see that, John?
Yeah. Be behind the plot.
But it only takes a couple of seconds.
Then we're going to do something. We're going to mount the wizard.
We're going to mount the wizard.
We're going to mount the wizard.
But it only takes a couple of seconds.
We're going to mount the wizard. And nobody's looking at you. We're going to mount the wizard. And nobody's looking at you.
Well, there's not going to be any bulge in there at all.
But it only takes a couple of seconds. Not something you can really do in front of spectators. Not something you can really do in front of spectators.
But it only takes a couple of seconds.
Not something you can really do in front of spectators.
There's not going to be any bulge in there at all.
I've done it when you've been waiting to start. I've actually picked it up and put it in there, and I've been stood at the side of two waitresses at the side of the room, and nobody's looking at you, but you reach under your jacket.
There's not going to be any bulge in there at all.
But you will find it comes out a lot easier if it's just a bit further up. If you don't jump around, it's not going to come out. If you don't jump around, it's not going to...
But it only takes a couple of seconds.